Okay, guys. So first of all, thanks for joining. Hello, everyone. I am Raj Singhal. I'm co-founder of Multiply.co. Over the last few months, we've been doing a series of sessions as part of our mission to share quality knowledge. And in continuation of that effort, we bring to you another of the masterclass on option strategies for investors by Manish Gupta, who is a fellow alumni from IIM Cal. Manish graduated from IMC in 2013. He has been trading in the Indian markets for about 6 years now. He trades automated and semi-automated strategies, which trade across index and stock futures and options and equities on equities. In simple words, he is pro in trading options on Indian equities. While many of you are already part of the Multiply community, where we have hundreds of people who are actively participating every day and coming to launch here and collaborate, to make our community even more stronger. But for those who are not yet members, we will be sending you an invite code post the session. So please download the app and join us. Without further ado, please welcome Manish.
Hi, thanks a lot. Thank you, Raj, for the introduction. Thank you, everybody, for joining on a Saturday morning. So we'll start with the session. Okay, as you know, the session covers options market and options strategy. Before starting, there are a few things that we should know, that options are leveraged instruments, and options have been described, and derivatives have been described by Warren Buffett as financial weapons of mass destruction. Okay, so whatever we do, we must understand that while trading options, there is a chance that we might lose more money than we have invested. Right, this is extremely important for us to know before we start. Okay. So this is what we will cover today in our presentation. First is the concept of leverage and margin. Next, what are options and how do they work? What are the type of options? And what can you achieve through options? Like, for example, there are various things that you can achieve with options. There are various trades that you can do to different ends. You can achieve different things. And that's what we will look into. At any point during the presentation, if you have questions, please feel free to ask your question in the chat box. I will cover those questions. I'll try to cover as many questions as possible towards the in the second half of the presentation. Okay. All right. Let's start with the concept of leverage and margin. Okay. So what is leverage? Leverage in financial markets is basically the same as leverage anywhere else. Okay. Suppose you want to move a block. A large block, and you cannot put enough force onto the block. So what you do is you put a sort of a lever in between, you put a fulcrum, and then you apply a force. So even if you apply a small amount of force on one end, the force gets multiplied by a certain number at the other end, and then you can move the heavy block, right? Leverage in financial markets, they work the same way. What that means is if you have 100 rupees to invest, you can lever, that is, take leverage on your investment by, say, a ratio maybe 6:1, so that your capital of 100 becomes capital of 600 when you're actually investing in the market, right? This is what we've tried to show here, that your initial capital of 600 can now become a notional value worth 600, okay? So, but this is a double-edged sword in the sense that imagine what happens if you've levered, say, 1:10. Which means that you have turned 10 rupees of your capital into 100 rupees, right? If there is a 2% loss in the market, right, you will lose 20 rupees, right? 2% of the notional value, because you have invested 1,000 rupees in the market. 2% of 1,000 is 20 rupees, right? So from an initial investment of 100 rupees, your capital now is 80 rupees because you've lost 20 rupees. So even though there is a small fall in the market of 2%, you end up losing 20% of your capital, right? It works the other way around also. If the market goes up 2%, you can gain 20% of your capital, right? So that's why it's leverage is a double-edged sword. But think about it. So if you've levered 1:100, then just 1% fall in the market, you can lose your entire capital. Right, so you turned your 10 rupees into 1,000 rupees. sorry, you turned your 100 rupees into 10,000 rupees. If the market falls 1%, you lose 100 rupees, which is your entire capital. Right. This is why when we trade using leverage, when we take leverage on our capital, we must be very, very careful in all our trades. Okay. Related to this is the concept of margin call. Okay. Now, what is margin call? Now, imagine the same example where you had invested 100 rupees, but you had levered it by a factor of 100 and your investment actually becomes 10,000, right? Imagine if there is a 1% fall in the market, right? At this point, you have lost all your capital, right? But you have not exited the position at this time yet. So what happens is at this point, your broker will call you and tell you to allocate more margin on the same position, right? In a sense, he's asking you to provide more capital, because any loss that you will face now beyond the 1% will be a loss for the broker himself, right? And the broker will not want to take a loss because of your positions. So by the time the market falls about 0.5% or 0.6%, in this case, the broker will give you a call and tell you to allocate more capital. And by the time the market falls by a percent, the broker will square off your positions. Right? This is for the broker to prevent facing any losses. This is what is margin call. So if you hear the news on any trading day, you will hear people say, especially on days when the market falls significantly, you'll hear that people talking about that. A lot of stop losses and a lot of margin calls were triggered, right? This is what happens, right? Where you levered your positions, the market fell, and the broker, in order to protect his capital, the broker will ask you to either provide more capital or the broker himself will square off all your positions, right? This is margin call. Before trading, we must ensure that we understand the concept of leverage and margin call, because in option trading, as we will see, it is very easy for you to lose a lot of money. I mean, at times, the loss can be more than what you've invested. Okay? Right. So this is what margin is. Say, for example, initially you deposit 25%, right? You make some profit. So this keeps increasing your margin. So this is mark-to-market profit. Suppose you bought something at 100 rupees. The market goes up by 10 rupees, right? So this 10% becomes your increase in basically account value. The next day, same thing happens again. You again make 10 rupees. So now your account value is 120 rupees. Okay. But next day, there is a large fall in the market. So you lose about, say, some 60 rupees, right? So now the broker will tell you that you have to deposit an additional amount of margin. You have to deposit an additional amount of margin to be able to keep the position. Otherwise, the broker will square off your position himself. Okay. So you can also use your stocks as margin, not just money. So for example, if you have 100 shares in a company A, which is worth say 5 lakh rupees, right? So you can pledge that to your broker. So now you have pledged 5 lakh rupees worth of assets to your broker. The broker will take a sort of a haircut on the investment, and on the rest of the money which is left, say in this case, what is left is 3.5 lakh rupees. So 3.5 lakh rupees will be credited to your trading account or margin account. Now you can take positions on 3.5 lakh worth of capital. Okay. Okay. So now let's come to the meat of the presentation, which is options. Okay. Now, what are options? The best way to think about options is to think about insurance. Okay. So what are insurance? Insurance is a product that I buy to protect myself from an adverse situation, right? So for example, I buy car insurance because if I have an accident tomorrow and I need to spend some amount of money on fixing my car, I can claim insurance and then I can use that money to fix my car, right? But what do you have to do to buy insurance? In order to buy insurance, there are a few things you must do. One is pay an upfront insurance premium. You pay this to your insurance provider, right? You also need to talk about the terms of insurance, in the sense that what is the maximum amount of money that the insurance provider will give you in case of certain situations, right? Basically, you get into a contract which says that if an event A happens, you get this amount of money. If an event B happens, you get this amount of money, and so on and so forth. Right? So this is insurance. You pay a premium, you get into a contract, and there is a finite lifetime of the insurance. That if I buy an insurance today, I am insured for, say, 10 years or 20 years. Now, what happens beyond 20 years is not covered by the insurance. If you want to be protected beyond 20 years, you need to buy another insurance, right? Or get into another contract or renew this insurance. But when you are entering the insurance contract, you are protected for a finite time from the day of insurance. Okay. Now, options work in a similar way, right? Options have a fixed expiry, which is a lifetime of the option. You pay a premium to have the privilege of getting paid if a certain event happens. Okay. You, as we've already discussed, that these are levered instruments, leveraged derivatives. Okay. Also take a moment to think about what happens to the person who's selling you the insurance. Right? The person who's selling you the insurance is ready to take the risk of having to pay you a lump sum in case of that event happens, right? Say, for example, if you have an accident in a car, then the insurance provider will have to pay you, say, 50,000 rupees in order for you to get your car fixed, whereas you paid only, say, 2,000 or 3,000 rupees in terms of your insurance premium, right? So the insurance seller is taking that risk to pay a lump sum in exchange for a relatively small amount of insurance premium. Okay. This is, so once you start understanding options in terms of insurance and insurance premiums, I think things become slightly easier for you to understand. Okay. Now, as we discussed, now options have strike prices. What we discussed is that options have a fixed expiry, right? In this case, what you see is a Reliance option with November expiry, okay, which is the fixed time to expiry. What we discussed for insurance was that you pay a premium. In this case, you are paying a premium of 36.5 rupees. Okay, you are buying an insurance here, right, at a premium of 36.5 rupees. You are buying an insurance in this case where at a strike price of 2600. Right, we will come to the call option part. We'll come to what CE means. But for now, understand that the event here is 2600. Right, if an event happens where Reliance, the underlying, crosses 2600, then you get paid. Right, you are buying an insurance on Reliance contract in the event of it crossing 2600. Okay. Now, there are two types of options. As you can see here, it is written CE. CE means call, European call. Okay. In India, there are only European options traded. There are no American options or other different kinds of options. So this E for us is slightly redundant. All options are European. Okay. Right. There are two types of options, call options and put options. Right. Now, again, go back to the insurance discussion. Okay. Now, in this case, in the case of insurance, we are buying a downside protection, right? What happens if I get a disease? What happens if my car has an accident? What happens if I lose my life, right? So these are downside protections, right? Which are equivalent to puts, right? So what does puts allow you to do is that suppose you are a fund manager, right? And you have 2,000 crores worth of stock positions. Right. Now, if an event like coronavirus happens, right, and the market lose, say, 50% in a matter of a couple of weeks, right, then as a fund manager, you've lost insane amount of money, right? People lost half of their savings, right? This is where put option comes in, right? You save your downside by buying puts. Okay. Suppose the index is at 15,000 and I want to make sure that my client's money is protected. So what I will do is I will buy puts for 12,000, which means that if the market falls beyond 12,000, I get paid. Who pays me? The person who I bought the option from. the person selling option in this case is equivalent to the person who sold me the insurance. Okay, so this means that when you are buying the option, you are buying insurance. When you are selling the option, you are selling the insurance, right? So when you are buying the insurance, what is your risk? Your risk is the premium that you have paid, right? So if I pay 5,000 rupees for my car premium and nothing happens to my car, so I lose the 5,000 rupees, right? For the person selling you the insurance, if nothing happens, he makes 5,000 rupees profit. But if the event which I'm insured against happens, then the person who sold me the insurance loses a lot of money, right? So he got 5,000 rupees, and if he pays me 50,000 rupees, his net loss is 45,000 rupees, right? So he is taking a lot of risk. It is similar in case of calls and puts, okay? So a call option gives you the right to buy at a certain price, right? To buy the underlying at a certain price, irrespective of where the actual price is, okay? Similarly, a put option gives you the right to sell at a certain price, irrespective of at where the price is, okay? Let me explain this. In this case, you are buying a call option at 2600 by paying a premium of 36.5. Quantity 250 means that you are getting into a contract to buy 250 shares, right? Now, consider what happens if the event of 2600 happens. Now, at expiry, suppose Reliance reaches 3000, okay? And I had sold you this call option, right? I sold you this call option at 2600 rupees, which means that irrespective of the price of Reliance shares on expiry, I will let you buy at 2600, 250 shares from me, right? So now, since the share price is 3000 rupees, I need to sell you 250 shares at 2600 rupees, right? Now I need to buy shares from the market at 3000 rupees to be able to sell you at 2600 rupees. So as the option seller, I lost a lot of money. I lost 250 into 400. This amount of money I lost, right, which is 1 lakh rupees. I lost 1 lakh rupees. You made a profit of 1 lakh rupees, right? Minus the insurance premium. You paid 36.5 into 250, which is 9,000. Roughly 10,000 rupees you paid as insurance premium and you made 1 lakh rupees, right? So net, your profit was about 99,000 rupees. For me, the loss was 99,000. Right. Similarly, it can happen with for a put option also. Suppose you had bought a 2600 put and Reliance price had ended at 2200. Right. Then the situation would have been the same, because with a put option, you bought the right to sell 250 Reliance shares to me at 2600 rupees. Right. So even if the market is at 2200 rupees, you sold me, I bought from you. You sold me the shares at 2,600 rupees. And I need to sell the shares in the market at 2,200 rupees. So I had a loss of 400 rupees per share. You had a profit of 400 rupees per share, right? Because you had bought the insurance. Now imagine what happens the other way around. What if you had sold the insurance, right? So when you are selling insurance, as I said, you get the insurance upfront. So whenever you sell an option, you get this 9,125 rupees upfront, right? So you might feel that this is free money, right? But this is not the case. So even if the share price today is at, say, 2,000 rupees, and you think that there is no way that Reliance can go up to 2,600 rupees in 1 month, so I will pocket this 9,125 rupees for free, right? This is not the case. The thing is that markets always price in all these things. Okay, so irrespective of where the price reaches, say for example, even if the price reaches at 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, whatever, right, you will be contract bound to sell me Reliance shares at 2,600 rupees, irrespective of what the actual price of the share is in the market, right? So basically, you can have an infinite amount of loss, right? Because if the share price reaches 5,600 rupees, then you lose 3,000 rupees per share, right? Because you have sold me the insurance. You told me when you get into this option contract, you tell me that I will sell you 250 Reliance shares at 2,600 rupees, irrespective of what the option price is, irrespective of what the share price is at the end of November, right? At the end of this, at the end of the expiry of this contract. Okay. Similar thing can happen in case of a put option. You can assume, you can say that markets are very bullish, markets will not fall. So today the index is at 15,000. Let me sell 15,000 puts because I am sure that the market will rally by the end of the November contract. Now, this is not, I mean, this is extremely risky, right? Because what if some event happens in the market and the market actually falls? Say, for example, coronavirus happens and the market falls 50%. Then, since you have sold a put option, you have got into a contract with me where you tell me that irrespective of what the underlying price is, I will buy index from you a certain quantity at 15,000 rupees. Right now, you are buying from me index at 15,000, although the index in the market is at 7,500. So you have again lost a lot of it. Right? This is why Warren Buffet called it financial weapons of mass destruction, because people at times, just because of making the insurance premium as profit, they get into these option contracts. And in case of any adverse move in the market, you can end up losing a lot. Right? So we look at something. This is something called a payoff diagram. Right? Now imagine this vertical line is 2,600. Okay. And this is the premium that you have paid. Suppose you've paid 100 rupees premium. So if the market reaches 2,700, then you will break even because you will make 100 rupees profit because 2,600 was the strike price and 2,700 is where the market is. Right. So if you have bought the insurance in this case, which is a call option, in this case, you make 100 rupees profit on the insurance, but you have paid 100 rupees premium also. So at 2,700, you are breaking even. Your profit is zero. If the market finishes at 2,650, somewhere around here, then you make 50 rupees loss because you paid 100 rupees premium and you made 50 rupees in profit. Okay. But what happens beyond 2,700 is pure profit. So if the market finishes at 2,800, you are 100 rupees in profit. If the market finishes at 3,000 rupees, you are net 300 in profit. If the market finishes at 50,000, you are 49,000 something else in profit. Right? What I'm trying to tell you is that you can basically make an infinite amount of money if the market goes up. But if you are short the option, you can lose an infinite amount of money also. Okay? This is something. Sorry, but so this is something that as options trader, you must understand that although it looks very rosy to be able to make us so much of money trading options, the risks are extremely real. That if you are short an option, you can lose an insane amount of money in case the event that you have insured somebody else against actually happens. Right? This is similar. Similar is the case for puts. What happens for puts is that as a buyer of option, you paid the premium for 2,600. So if the market expires at 2,500, you make 100 rupees in profit and you have paid 100 rupees in premium. So net net, you are flat. But if the market falls to 2,000, then as an option buyer, you can make some profit. But as option seller, you will again lose a lot of money. Okay. So trade options very carefully. Okay. This is what happens in case of short option. This is the premium for the person. This is the payoff diagram for a person who is buying the option. This is the payoff diagram for the person who's selling the option, right? So he makes the premium till the time the event does not happen. when the event happens, he starts to lose money. Say, for example, in our case, if the stock price finishes below 2600, then you will not exercise that option, right? If the stock price is at 2500, you will not buy at 2600, right? So the person who sold you the insurance makes the 100 rupees in profit. But as soon as the stock price starts to rise beyond 2600, the insurance seller, he starts to lose money. Okay. So if it finishes at 2650, then he makes 50 rupees profit because he loses 50 rupees on the trade, but he made 100 rupees on the insurance, on the insurance premium. Similarly is the case with the put option. Okay. Right. So now we look at option strategies. Okay. What are options used for? This was how options work. It is extremely important to know how options work. Okay. Now, since you know how options work, it is relatively easier to see what kind of different option strategies can. Right. First, that we all already discussed is hedging. Hedging means that if you are a fund manager, you can buy put options. Right. So that when the market falls, you can make money with put options, right? So for example, if the index is at 15,000, you bought 12,000 puts or maybe 14,000 puts. So when the market starts to fall, you will have 1,000 rupees loss from 15,000 to 14,000. But if the market falls beyond 14,000, you will start to make money on your put option positions, right? So you are protected on the downside to a certain extent. In this case, your loss will be covered up to, your loss will be a maximum of 1,000 rupees. Because if the market reaches 5,000, then you will lose 10,000 rupees on your stock positions, but your profit will be 9,000 rupees on your option positions. So your net loss is restricted to 1,000 rupees. This is why it is called a protective put. You are protecting your downside, right? Now you can make additional money. So this is one way of trading options where you are protecting your downside. The other way of trading options is, the other reason of trading options is covered calls. Okay. Say for example, you have 250 shares in Reliance. Okay. And you are of the belief that Reliance share prices will not rise beyond say 3,000. Okay. So you sell call options for 3,000 rupees. So what happens is, Now, since you're already holding Reliance shares, if the market reaches 3,000, then basically in this case, your upside is covered at 3,000. Even if the market reaches, say, 5,000 rupees, you have already entered into a contract to sell Reliance at 3,000 since you've sold a call option. Right. So in this case, you have got into a contract where you will make some insurance money, where you will make some premium. Call option premium that you are getting when you are selling the option. But in this case, if the stock price rises beyond 5,000, then you don't get paid for the 3,000 to 5,000 range or whatever, for anything above 3,000. Even if the stock price reaches 10,000, your upside is capped at 3,000. Okay. This is called covered call, where you sell an option. And at that point, you say that you will not participate in any upside beyond this strike in exchange for a small amount of premium. Okay. Now, buying and selling through options. This is something that people in the market do very, very regularly. Okay. Now, suppose you want to buy Reliance shares. Okay. And today the stock price is, say, at 3,000 rupees. But you say that you want to buy 2,500 rupees and not 3,000. So what people do is they generally sell a put at 2,500 rupees. Right. So if the market does not reach 2,500, you make the insurance premium, right? For the premium that you get while selling option, you get insurance premium while selling the option, right? So in this case, if the market reaches 2,500, now you can buy stock for 2,500 and you made some money with the premium. So you made 20 rupees in premium and you were able to buy 2,000 stock at 2,500. It's very good, right? But imagine what happens if the stock reaches at 2,000, right? If the stock reaches 2,000, then even in this case, you are liable to buy the same stock at 2,500, right? So again, it is similar is the case to sell, right? If you already have shares in a company and you want to sell share at say 3000 rupees, you can sell 3000 rupees call option, but you are making a decision the moment you get into the contract, right? In case of buying, if you are in case you want to buy the stock and you sell a put at a certain price, you have basically made a decision that irrespective of where the price is, I will buy at that strike price. So even if the market falls 90%, you will be liable to buy that share at the strike price at which you had sold the put option. Similarly, in case of selling, the market rises 200%, you will be liable to sell the stock at the strike price at which you sold. Okay. So the other thing is people do directional trade on options, right? What is directional trade? Directional trade is basically that I am bullish on a call, I am bullish on a certain stock, so I will buy a call. If I'm bearish on a certain stock, I will buy a put, right? So for example, this is something which happened on 13th of October, that the stock in IRCTC was at 49.50. Okay. 14th October intraday, it reached 5,600. So if you had bought a call option, 5,500 call option on IRCTC on the 13th close, you were able to buy it at 39 rupees. Right. But the price of the same instrument on 14th was 390. Right. So you made about 900% return. Right. But imagine what happens to the person who sold you this insurance, sold you this call option. Right. Similarly is the case with puts. Okay. So on the 28th of October, so this was after a split. IRCTC had split 1:5. So on the 28th of October, the close price was 912. On the 29th, intraday it fell 30%. Right. So and a 600 put, which was about 5.5 rupees, it rose to 128 rupees intraday on the 28th, on the 29th. So you made about 2,200%. This is the kind of money that people can make trading directional bets in options. But beyond this, return is also the plight of the person who sold you this contract. Okay, so whenever you are trading option, please make sure that you understand what you are doing. Okay, now these are all directional trades basically, right? This is a directional trade. Now there are also non-directional trade in case of options, which are slightly more involved. Okay, what happens is in these cases, you are not trading in terms of direction, right? You buy option and you do something called gamma scalping, okay, which is a slightly involved concept. So we'll not go into details in this case right now. Okay, this is also a straddle and strangle. These are two kind of non-directional trades which people trade in case of options. Okay, now what are other levered instruments? Apart from this, there are also other levered instruments, right, which are futures, wherein there is no strike price. There is just an unlimited upside and unlimited downside, right? Similarly, there are forwards. Forwards are similar to futures contract, but they are customizable according to your needs. They are generally not traded over exchanges. Forwards are traded over OTC markets, where different parties get into different customized contracts with different payoff structures. Okay. Now, partly paid stock. Partly paid stocks are also some sort of levered instrument. So, for example, you must have seen Reliance partly paid stocks trade on the exchanges few days ago. I think those partly paid stocks have already been converted into stocks, if I'm not wrong. But what happens in case of partly paid stocks is that the movement in these stocks is very similar to the actual stock, right? But you pay only part for this stock, hence partly paid stock, right? Say, for example, if the stock is trading at 100 rupees, for the same stock, a partly paid stock can trade at, say, 20 rupees, right? But the upside of these are relatively significantly similar. So, for example, if the stock price rises to 120, in most cases, partly paid stocks will rise from 20 to 40, right? But this is not always the case because there are always liquidity considerations involved. But this is what partly paid stocks are. Okay. This is it from my side. Now we will start to take questions. Okay. So one of the questions is that some countries like Germany have something called knock-in knock-out option. This question is asked by Vikrant. Vikrant, these options, these kind of options are something called exotic options. Right. So exotic options are something that that are not traded over the exchanges in India. So let me read the entire question first. Okay. So Vikrant asks, some countries like Germany have something called knockouts. They don't have options and futures. Can you please explain the difference? Okay. So so as I said, that these knockouts are exotic options. These exotic options are something similar to what we discussed called forwards. These are not traded over the exchanges. These are generally traded between people. Okay. OTC, over the contract, over the counter. Okay, these contracts are negotiated between two people. There are many different kind of exotic options called knock-in knockouts. There are ladders. There are binary options. These are extremely involved options, which we don't get into. They are extremely mathematically complex structures, not traded over the exchanges. So this is not in our purview today. Okay. Which markets share commodities are less traded with options? See, it depends on your view. Basically, you express your views through options, right? So if your view is that gold will rise, then you would choose to trade on gold. If your view is that equity markets will rise, then you will rise or fall, then you will express your views through options, right? So there is no one, reason. There is no one reason for me to say if one market is more riskier than the other. It is just about your views, about how you express your views through options. Okay. Does that, I hope that answer your question, Vikrant. Okay. So I think, possible use cases. Should anyone having a stock portfolio also buy a put option all the time in order to hedge against a falling product market? This is a very good question. Okay. Siddharth, this is a very good question. Okay. Ideally, yes. Okay. Because if you have a portfolio of, say, 1 crore rupees, you should have some downside protection for your portfolio. Okay. But the thing with buying a put option all the time is that if the event does not happen, then you lose that insurance premium. Say, for example, in case of, suppose you have 1 crore worth of portfolio across stocks, right? So maybe you want to buy a protection on the index. Okay, this is what you thought, that maybe because you have a lot of stocks which cover a broad number of sectors and a broad number of stocks, so it is better for me to buy protection on the index. But the thing is, in order to buy protection on the index, you must also pay a premium. So if the index does not fall, you lose your premium, right? So it is, again, not a very easy thing to do. Because if the event does not happen, you lose returns if the market, they start to eat into your returns, right? So if you buy a option premium for 100 rupees, if the event does not happen, you lose the 100 rupees. That is, so they, that 100 rupees eats into your return. Hence, you should always have some protection, but it is a call that you need to take whether you are ready to lose some amount of your upside to be protected on the downside. Okay. Right. Next question is asked by Manish. When to sell option covered call? Okay. Now, when to sell is again depending on your view. Okay, say for example, you have stock in a company A, okay, and the current stock price is 100 rupees. Okay, should you sell a call for 150 rupees today? Okay, that is the question that you, if that is the question you are asking, you should know that what is your view on the stock. If your view on the stock is that I'm very bullish, the market is very bullish, the company has earnings announcement in 2 days, okay, do you think if the stock can rise 50%? Right? If you think yes, then you should not. If you think no, then maybe you can choose to sell a call option on this company at 150 rupees. But you must also see if it's worth the risk, right? In the sense that if you are getting only 2 rupees worth of premium, then would you, if you are getting only 2 rupees worth of premium, would you want to sell protection to somebody else, right? So basically, you must do a risk reward sort of an analysis for yourself, that where am I comfortable selling a call, at what time in the expiry? Should I sell it at the beginning of the expiry, or should I wait till a few days into the expiry? Okay. So these are the pros and cons, and these are the trade-offs that you must think for yourself. It is very difficult for any one person to say when is the perfect time to do this. Okay. Okay. A lot of you want to know how settlement happens in stocks and index. Okay. So, in India, stocks are physically settled and index is cash settled. What that means is, if you hold a call option which is in the money, which means that if, so for example, the example that we had looked at, let me go back to the slide. Okay, here. Okay. So in this case, if you are long this option, if you have bought this option and the market expires at 3,000 rupees, right? So in this case, the person who sold you the option will give you 250 shares and you will have to pay him 2,600 rupees. 2,600 into 250, right? This is what physically settled means, that there will be an exchange of the underlying. In this case, Reliance. So the person who sold you this option will sell you Reliance shares and you will pay him 2,600 into 250 rupees. Okay. So this is one reason why, I mean, if you've traded options lately, any of you, you would see that Zerodha or whichever broker you are trading with would want to ensure that you have the required premium in your account if as you go closer to the expiry. Right. So, for example, if I had this sort of a option in my book on the expiry day, and if the market was at 2,600, Zerodha would ensure that I have 2,600 into 250 rupees in my Zerodha trading account on the day of expiry. Okay. Index, on the other hand, is cash settled, which means that in case of an index, the is a trade, the PNL is exchanged. Okay, so for example, assume that this was index, right? So you had bought a call for 2,600 on the index and the index expired at 3,000. So the person selling you the insurance will pay you 3,000 minus 2,600, which is 400, into 250, because there is no underlying to be exchanged in case of index. Okay, so stocks are settled physically, and the index is settled in cash. Okay. Next question is, what is time decay in options? Okay. All right. So imagine you're buying insurance. Okay. So if I buy an insurance today for 5 years horizon, I have to pay a certain amount of premium. Okay. Let's assume that I have to pay 5,000 rupees on any event. Let's call an event A. So I'm buying an insurance on event A today for 5 years, and the insurance premium for that is 5,000 rupees. Okay. Now imagine if I want to buy the same insurance on the same event, but for a shorter time horizon. Okay, say 5 months or 6 months. In this case, would the premium be lower or higher? The premium would be lower, right? Because the person who's selling me the insurance because I'm not insured for that long a period, right? If I was insured for 5 years, I paid 5,000. But if I'm insured only for 6 months, then I must pay less, right? I will not pay 5,000 rupees for 6 months if I'm paying 5,000 rupees for 5 years, right? So for 6 months, the insurance premium will be significantly less, right? This is similar to what is a time decaying option, right? So for example, assume that I sold you this call option on Reliance for 2,600 rupees. Today, the premium is 36.5 rupees, right? And today there is 1 month to expiry. Okay. Now time goes by. Okay. And nothing happens, right? The stock price remains in 2,500 rupees range. Okay. Now, if there are only 2 days to expiry and you want to be insured against the same event of 2,600 rupees, will you again pay 36 rupees? Most likely not, right? Because when you had 1 month to expiry, you were ready to pay 36 rupees for the insurance, for the premium of the insurance, right? But if there are only 2 days to expiry, you would not want to pay 36 rupees. You might want to only pay 2 rupees or 3 rupees or 5 rupees. This is time decaying option. Since I had sold you this option at 36.5 rupees when there was 1 month to expiry, the event does not happen. So the insurance starts to lose its premium, right? Because you are insured against the same event, but the time over which that event can happen reduces. So in essence, the probability of the same event happening reduces. Hence, the option starts to lose its premium. Okay, this is what time decay is. It is basically the slow decay of option price with respect to time. Okay. A lot of people want to know about long-term hedging. Okay, how should you hedge for 3 to 4 month long position given the liquidity issue? Okay, this is again a very good question, but the thing is that in India, long-term options are not very liquid, right? Especially on stocks. For long-term insurance, it is best to buy options. In India, options are, even in case of index, there are only a few options and few strikes on which you can buy long-term option. I think NSE allows up to 6 months or maybe up to 3 years, if I'm not wrong, but those options are hardly liquid. So you might have to pay a certain amount of spread for this, but buying options is a good way of insuring against long-term, basically protecting your downside for the long term. So next question is, can you share the recent successful option trade and your strategy? Okay. Now, this is slightly tricky for me, to be honest. Okay. Because I don't trade options in terms of direction, right? Because I'm an options market maker. What market makers do is, so for example, when you trade, right, you say both bid and the offer, right? You don't see one price in the market, you see bid and offer. Now imagine if you can buy it, you know, imagine the bid offer in the market is say 20 and 30, right? You have a buy order at 20 and you have a buy order at 30. If both of your orders are traded, then you make 10 rupees profit, right? Without taking more or less any risk, right? This is what I do. I'm an options market maker, where I have orders on both sides of the book across a lot of expiries and across a lot of options, across a lot of stocks also, right? So this way, I don't have a successful trade as such, because I don't take a directional bet in the market where I say that, say for example, IRCTC also in this case, right? It is not my job bet on IRCTC long or IRCTC short. What I do is I make markets in IRCTC where I am both the buyer and the seller. So for example, as I told you in this case, that you can either be an insurance buyer or an insurance seller. In my strategy, I am both an insurance buyer and an insurance seller. Okay, so I understand that it is slightly difficult to get your head around probably, but that's the way I trade. Okay. Do bonuses, splits, and other corporate events have any effective options, do we get a profitable opportunity? Okay. So two things. Okay. So let's talk about what happens when the event happens, when a split happens, and you already have a position in the option. Okay. As you would imagine, in this case, nothing can happen. There is no trading opportunity as such. You do not make any PNL in this case if you already have a position, right? So for example, imagine that you have a car which is insured, right? Now you bought your insurance from company A. Now if company A is acquired by company B, right, it does not have any bearing on your car insurance, right? Because that is a contract that you had already entered into. Right. Now, if company A is acquired by company A, it is their business, not your business. Your business is that you already have a legal contract with company A. So your insurance is not affected by corporate events between company A and B. Similarly, your option position is not affected by any corporate event on the firm or on the company. Okay. What happens is basically the strike price might change. So for example, as we looked at in this example, right? So on the 30th of October, stock price in IRCTC was about 5,000. IRCTC on 20th October was at 1,000 rupees, right? So basically this was a 5:1 split. So what happens in this case is that strike prices adjust. So what was 5,500 call on the 13th October will become 1100 call on the 28th October. Okay. So if you are already holding a position, then there is no bearing on your position due to a split or anything, due to any corporate event. Right. Now, any other trading strategy that you can come up with is again dependent on what your view is. Right. So for example, it happens at times that if there is a split, say for example, IRCTC 1:5 split, what happens at times is that liquidity rises in the counter due to split, right? And hence at times there is an upward drift to the share price. So if such a thing is announced, maybe you can try to make money off this gain in liquidity. But again, this is not certain at all. I cannot say that it will always happen, right? So that's it basically. It is very difficult to say that you can make money on corporate events any more than you can make money on trading as such. Okay. Can you briefly explain Nifty 50 option chain, IPM, OTM, IPOM? Okay. So Nifty 50 option chain is option chain is options written on one underlying across strikes. Okay, so for example, in case of IRCTC, when the stock was at 5,000, you will have 5,000 call, 5,100, 200, 300 calls, and you have similar puts, right? So this whole thing together makes the option chain. Okay, now option chain means that now you can trade a number of strikes. So for example, you can trade 5,000, you can trade 5,100, 5,500, whatever, right? Now, the importance of option chain is because people can express different views, right? If I'm very bullish, I can buy 5,000 calls, right? If I'm bullish, but I don't want to take that kind of a risk with my premium, then I will buy 5,500 calls because the premium of 5,500 call will be lesser than that of 5,000, right? But also the chances of making money in 5,500 is slightly less than the chance of money that you can make with 5,000 call. Okay, so basically looking at option chain, you can say that this is what the drift in market is. What is ITM? ITM means in the money. In the money means that people who are strikes which are lower than the present strike price. Okay, so for example, in this case, 4,952 is the price, right? So 5,500 is OTM, out of the money. Out of the money means if the option were to expire now, say, for example, in this case, if today was the expiry, then will the holder of 5,500 make any money, right? In this case, the answer is no. 5,500 call is OTM, out of the money, given the current price. But if you were holding 4,500 call, then you would be in the money, right? Because if you were holding 4,500 call, you will make about 450 rupees, right? So this is how calls are in the money. But if you had 5,500 puts, right? 5,500 puts, and if the market is at 49.50, then you will make 5,500 rupees, right? Because you can sell the stock at 5,500, which the stock which is presently at 4,950, right? This is what ITM and OTM means. Okay, what is IV? IV again is a slightly involved concept. IV means implied volatility. Implied volatility is an input to the Black-Scholes model, where implied volatility is the price, is the vol at which the option price equals the present option price. Right. So basically, implied volatility is a way of market to price future movement in the market. Right. So for example, if implied volatility is high, that means that that market is viewing, market believes that that in this expiry or whatever time is left in the expiry, there will be large movement in the stock. Right. If the IV is low, then the market believes that the chances of a large movement in the market is relatively lower. Okay. This is why you would see that implied volatility on index is lower than implied volatility on individual stocks. Okay. So because it is harder for index to move 10% in a day, but stocks can move 10% in a day relatively easier. Right. So IV on stocks will always be higher than IVs on index. OI is option in, open interest. Open interest basically means that what are the number of outstanding positions in that strike, right? So for example, if there is nobody trading in the market at a particular strike, option OI is zero, right? If there is only one person who trades, say for example, I sold you one option, then OI is one, okay? So basically, OI is a measure of the trading interest in the market, right? The higher the OI, the higher is the trading interest in the market. Now, people analyze OI in order to see where support and resistance is in the market, right? So for example, if the index OI at a certain strike is extremely high, then that becomes a sort of a support and resistance in the market. And a lot of people trade according to these support and resistances in the market, based on where the OI is. Okay. I think we're out of time. Okay, I think this was the last question. Let me unmute Raj and we'll draw into this. Thanks a lot for listening. I hope I was able to answer at least some of your questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Manish, for such a wonderful session. I think you covered, I think it's a very vast and a deep topic. So definitely one session is never enough. So hope to see you again sometime in future to do the part two of this session. But thanks a lot for doing this. And sure. Thanks a lot for all the people who had signed in. I think the questions were great. Definitely a lot, very, looked like that, we're very engaging as well. And if we were not able to answer any questions, we will pick that up. And we will try and answer them, in the email which we will send it to you. So do look out for an email where we will also share the recording of this so that you can listen to it again. And please, to people who have not signed into our app, we have a great amount of conversations going on the Multiply platform, creating this great platform where people can come and ask any kind of questions and queries on investing. So please do join us. Use the code OPTIONS, OPTIONS. To sign in, it's still an invite only, but for people who are joining, who have joined to this session, so we have created this code. So do join us and see you on the app. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.